Okay.
Okay, so today I am going to show you the RDBMS installation. Okay, so how to install the RDBMS. Okay, so we have installed the Linux, right? Now I will install the RDBMS. Click on this virtual machine and power on.
Installation or Subas. Subas.
Okay, so once Linux installation is complete, then you will get this pop up. Okay, so maximize this screen, just press Ctrl Alt and maximize, then forward. Yes, I agree. Next, and make it disabled. Next. Yes. Okay. So also you can make it disabled. Next. Yes. Forward. Set the timing. It's okay. Now just forward. Continue. Forward and finish. Okay. So Linux installation is complete. Now I'm going to, after once the Linux installation is complete, you have to install the VMware tools. Okay, so why we install the VMware tools? If you want to copy the Windows files or folders here in the Linux, then you have to install the VMware tools, because if you don't have, then you cannot copy and paste the Windows any files and folders from Windows. If you want to copy any files and folders from Windows, you have to install the VMware tools. You can share the Windows folder, Windows operating system folder. Let me start recording. Okay, so you will get the pop up. Then you have to enter username is a root and password is Oracle. Then login and then click on VMware tools, VM and install VMware tools. Yes, yes. Okay, now click on this folder. Now extract to desktop. Now click on extract. Okay, now this to this has been extracted. Then close off and go to the VMware tools and click here and run all terminal and just keep pressing enter. Keep pressing enter. Then enter, enter, enter. Now stop for some time. Keep pressing enter, enter. Now wait for some time. Now again enter. Enter, enter. Okay, now VMware installation is VMware tool installation is complete. Now maximize this screen. Okay, you will get the full screen, but we are not getting, so just restart. Now login with the root password oracle. If you maximize this screen, now you will get the full screen. What happens? Still not getting. Yeah, now you can get. So VMware tool installation is complete. Now we are going to install the RDBMS. Oracle RDBMS. So before installing the RDBMS, Oracle RDBMS, there are three steps. Pre-installation step, installation step, and post installation steps. So we have to follow these three steps before installing the RDBMS. In this step, in pre installation step, you have to make a few settings in the operating system. You have to make few settings. So what are the settings? You want to install the RDBMS, you have to create the user. That user will install the Oracle software. So we need to create the user. Before creating the user, that user must be part of a group in Linux. In the Linux, we must one user must be part of a group. So we need to create the group first, and then we have to assign that user to that group. So we need two group, oinstall and dba. Oinstall is used only for installation purpose, Oracle RDBMS installation purpose, and dba to manage the database. So we need two groups, and I will create one user. This is the groups, two groups we create, and Oracle user. Oracle is the user. And these are two groups. So this Oracle user can install the RDBMS, also can handle the database activity. So what I have to do? I have to assign this user to both groups. Okay, this user will be part of both groups, oinstall and DBA. Then what you have to do? You have to give the permission where you want to install the RDBMS, which on which mount point you want to install the RDBMS. So you have to change the ownership permission. Change ownership permission where you want to install RDBMS. Okay. So if I have created a mount point E01, right? So E01 will store only RDBMS files, only binaries file, only Oracle product. So on E01, you have to give the ownership to Oracle user, and you have to also give the read, write, and execute permission on that mount point. Okay, and give directory permission on mount point. Okay, so you have to follow this step while installing the RDBMS, and then in the you have to set the kernel parameter and security limit. In the operating system, you have to change two files. You have to make the changes in two files. One is the kernel parameter.
Subhash.
And other is security limits. Yes.
Subhash, what is mount point?
Mount point is nothing but a partition. We have created the digital
okay.
one, disk one, disk two, right?
Okay. Okay.
Okay. Okay. So this is the mount point. Whatever I have created. While installing the Linux. Now you have to change the two files. One is the security limit files, and another is the kernel parameter. So what is the security limit and kernel parameters? I will show you. So security limit is, we have two types of limit: number of process and number of files. You can set the limit. Number of process means this Oracle user can use how many maximum number of processes. You can set the limit. So this user, you can see the soft and hard. Soft is default and hard is maximum limit. So Oracle user can use between 2047 to 18,384. This Oracle user can open this much processes till 16,384. And number of files, this Oracle user can use how many number of files. So this is a default one, 1024 is a default, and this is the maximum number of files Oracle user can open. Okay. And in the kernel parameter, yes.
So what, these all values are default values?
This is not default. Actually, yeah. If you are installing the Oracle Enterprise in a Linux, there no need to set.
Okay.
If okay. Installing in a Red Hat Linux, then you have to set default. You have to configure this file if you are using the Red Hat Linux.
Red Hat Linux, okay.
Yeah, but Oracle Enterprise Linux, no need to change these settings. It will be already already configured.
Okay.
Okay. And the kernel parameter, this is the kernel parameter. You can set the maximum size of your for Oracle. So maximum memory size you want to how much maximum memory size you want to allocate for the Oracle software. So if your total RAM size is 8 GB, so what you can do, you can dedicate 6 GB for Oracle. Okay, you can allocate 6 GB for Oracle software. So Oracle software cannot use more than 6 GB of memory. If you install different software, different databases, if you create the different databases, then your memory size should not be exceed more than this limit, more than 6 GB. So suppose that one database, you created one database and memory size is 2 GB. So you can create how many databases? Maximum 3 databases you can create in the system. If you set the kernel such a max value 6 GB, you can create only 3 databases. If you try to create 4th database, it not open because it's maximum limit. So you can set the maximum memory limit in the CTL kernel parameter. Okay, so this is the pre-installation step. This is the pre-installation step. So now if you want to, I will show you how to do that. So this is the root user and I am going to create a directory. Okay, so I'm going to add two groups, DBA group and OInstall group. This group is already added, so you cannot create one more group with the same name. And we need to add OInstall group for installation purpose. Tomorrow I will show you Linux administration part. I will show you at that time tomorrow, so don't worry. So how to add the user in Oracle? This is the command user add and hyphen g. We are going to add this Oracle user in two groups, DBA and OInstall. So OInstall is the primary group and DBA is the alternative group. So if you create this user, create the user like this. Oracle user already exists. Now give the ownership permission to U01 on U01 for Oracle and group is OInstall. For DBA also give it. For DBA also. And I am going to keep the software the unzip file where in the OPT folder. So on OPT folder and also give the permission. Okay, so now I'm going to change the file and folder permission. So this one I will explain you tomorrow. So we have different type of permission, U01 and OPT. Okay, so I'm giving read, write and execute permission on mount point U01 and OPT. So this is a read, write and execute. If you give the 777, this is a read, write and execute permission on the directory, on the mount point. And this file, there is no need to set. It will be already set. If you want, you can set vi etc sysctl.conf. You can say this file will be set. So no need to change anything. Okay. Just press Control C. Okay, these two files no need to set, security limits and this CCTL kernel parameter. So now pre-installation step is done. Yes, Ravan. Yes, Ravan, tell me. Okay, now I'm going to install the RDBMS. So how to install the RDBMS? So you must have the unzip file, right? So cd disk one. how to open that software is there where in Windows operating system. So we have shared the you have to share the software first. So go to the VM settings and option share folder and always enabled and then add it next. So select the unzip file wherever you have downloaded. Go to that location. I have downloaded here. So my software is there in this folder. This is Oracle 11 RDBMS Grid. Okay, now finish. Okay, now you can get. Just go to the chain directory to CDMNT and AGFS. Okay, and go to chain directory to Oracle RDBMS. Go to that directory. Now I'm going to unzip this software where at OPT mount point. So paste it -d and OPT. Okay, so it will take time. Okay, so meanwhile I'll explain you how the update statement works. Yesterday I was not able to show you. So I was not able to explain you. So today I'm going to explain you. Okay, so how the update statement works, I'm going to show you, explaining. So if you add any update statement, like update name update EMP. I'm going to update employee table. Set value equal to 5000 where equal to 4000. Okay, so any user fired the update statement. Any user fired the update statement. So first user has to be logged in the application, right? User has put the username and password and service name. Now user process is started. Once the user is authenticated, now the server process is started. Now server will allocate a memory area for that, and session memory area, that is called the user global area. Okay, so that user is authenticated, got authenticated, server process is started. Now then it will check the permission on this library cache, update permission on library cache on the empty table. Now if it is also passed, then it will go to this memory area, it will search the data in the memory area. If it is not and if it is not there in the memory area buffer cache, then it will go to the data file, and then this data will be placed in the buffer cache. In which buffer it will be placed, what will be the status for that buffer earlier? Status is free buffer. It will be loaded in free buffer. This is a free buffer earlier. So now your data is loaded here in the free buffer. So 5000 is loaded here. Alright, we are changing from 4000 to 5000. So 4000 data is loaded here. Okay, now we are going to change. So we are going to change this value will get overwritten, right? So before overwriting, this value will be also will be stored in the undo table space. It will be stored in the undo table space, old value. So 4000 will be stored here, and then it will get overwritten. Now it will get overwritten. So 4000 has been changed to 5000 now. It has been changed to 5000 now. Now what is the status of this block? It's a dirty now. Once you modify this block, the status will be changed to from free to dirty. So this block is now dirty. So once it become dirty, it will be part of the checkpoint queue, right? And all changed data will be written to the where? You know that it will be written to the redo log file, right? When you modify something, so 5000 entry will be written here also in the redo log file. Okay, and once you perform the commit, then what happens? It will generate a system change number like 101. This is a system change number for this transaction. So let me start another one. So this tab 2 here, and if second file, press tab, then you will get this. And here mention 2. Now, so once you perform the commit, system change number will be generated, and this data will be written to the redo log file along with the system change number. So 5000 will be written here, 5000 with the system change number 101. Okay, so once you perform the commit, that data will be written in the redo log file, and it is placed in the earlier, it has been already placed in the checkpoint queue. Now after some times, if you don't have enough space, then database writer will write the dirty modified data in the data file. Okay, database writer will write, if you don't have enough free space or whatever the events I have explained you, that event occurs, then database writer will write modified buffers from the data files, from buffer cache to data file. Okay, so this is the process how your update statement works. Now user will get the confirmation that your transaction is committed. Your transaction is committed, now it's permanent. So this is how update statement works. So I have already uploaded the notes. Just you can go through the notes. There also it's clearly mentioned. This Oracle architecture note. So this is the update statements. how does it work? So you can see here, the first process is, first step is, user process will be started, then server will allocate a session area, that is server process will started, and then first step, if the data is not there in the buffer cache, then it will copy the data from the data file to buffer cache. Okay, now the data has been modified, now it's read, so this data has been modified. Once it is modified, it has been written to the read log buffer, and also whole transaction is written to the callback segment and to table space. Okay. And then the whole transaction also will be written in the read log buffer. Okay. Now, if the transaction is committed, commit here, you can see commit. Once the transaction is committed, then the change data is written in the read log file. And you will get the message that commit is successful. Commit is successful, but data has not been written in the data file. Database files, we have old data only, unmodified data. Okay. So in the data file, once you perform the commit, this is a 12th step. Database writer will write modified data from the buffer cache to data file. This is how update statement works. Any doubt, anyone?
No, boss, you can go ahead.
Okay, so that was the update. How does it work? Now I am going to show you the installation, how to install the RDBMS. Before installing the RDBMS, open a terminal and type xhost plus. It will give the option to open the graphical user interface. Otherwise, you cannot open the graphical user interface. So now go to the this folder where we have unzipped in OPT. Now connect with the Oracle user. Switch user to Oracle. Now go to the OPT folder. For mount client, come to the database, run installer. This is the installation file.
Subhash. For that, you should be a user of all.
Yes, you have to type xhost plus. Okay. So now, otherwise, if you don't type, try it in your system, you will get error. So now, uncheck this and next. Yes. And then skip the software updates. Click on next. And then I'm going to only install the RDBMS. I'm not going to create the database. So select the second option. I will create the database later. Now this is a single instance database. Now next. There are two location, Oracle base and software location. So Oracle base location is the common location for all software files. Okay. So suppose that if you in one machine, you have different version of database, 10G, 11G, 12C. All database version will be stored in this location. All database version product information will be stored in this location. So this is a root location. And the software location is the different. So for each database, we will have a particular software location. For 11G, we have different location. For 12C, we have different. Okay, so each database version will have the RDBMS version will have the different location. You cannot install this all RDBMS version in the same location. We must have a different binaries. For all different database version will have different binaries. So you have to store at different places. So this is the location for Ubuntu. So now source type select and tackle inventory group the install. Now select next. Add administrator group is the ODB DBA, and it will take the prerequisites. If is there any error, you will get it here. Now just maximize this screen and now install. So this installation will be done. It will take 30 to 45 minutes. After installation, you have to go for post installation step. You have to follow the post installation step. In the post installation step, we have to execute two commands, two scripts. So what are the scripts? There are two scripts you have to execute. These are the two scripts you have to execute. So in the post installation step, you have to execute inst root.sh. If you execute this script, then it creates the inventory pointer. Okay, so one inventory pointer will be created in this location, etc or inst.loc. This file shows the inventory location and group it's linked to. So when you start up, when you try to start the database, then first it has to go to the binaries where it is stored. So one inventory pointer will be created, and then it change the permission to 771 read write execute. I will explain you. It will change the 77 permission for ORA inventory. 77 permission is the read write execute and only read permission. So first is for group, second is for owner, second is for group, and last one is for public. So I will explain you what it is tomorrow. It will change the permission to ORA inventory, and it will change the group name to oinstall. So oinstall is the owner of this group, owner of this ORA inventory. Then you have to run root.sh. If you run the root.sh, then one ORA tab file will be created. There is one ORA tab file will be created. So we have here VI CD. This is the ORA. CD etc. etc. Here one ORA tab file will be created. ORA tab. You can see here ORA tab is not there. There is no ORA tab file. So if you run the script, one ORA tab file will be created, and there you create any database that entry will be there in this ORA tab file. If you create any database, prod database, test database, that database name will be stored here in this ORA tab file. So this is also used to identify how many databases are there in the machine using ORA tab file. You can refer the ORA tab file. And if you want to start up and shut down the, you want to shut down the database automatic, if you want to make it automatic, then you can make the settings in ORA tab. If you run this script root.sh, then ORA tab file will be created. And it also set the Oracle base and home environments. Okay, so Oracle base is what the location we have mentioned at the time of installation, and Oracle Home, whatever we have mentioned the location at the time of installation, so it will set the environments for that. So Oracle file, this file we use to make automatic database shutdown and startup, and we can identify how many databases are there on in the server. Okay, so it will take time. I will upload a video. Okay, once it's done. Okay, so you can leave the session. Now you have to run this script. So what you have to do? Just copy. Just click here. Okay, maximize this. And click here and just press Ctrl C, and then open a terminal. Open terminal and run this. Okay, now we have to run the second script. Okay, now copy this, Control C, and then open the terminal. And run this script. Keep pressing enter. Okay, so your database RDBMS installation is successful. Tomorrow I will show you the Linux administration.